In 4 short years, the Nintendo Switch has managed to establish 2 lasting legacies in video game history. The first, astronomical sales. With nearly 80 million units sold, the Switch is the 11th highest selling console of all time, right behind the PSP? Is that right? Okay. I mean, a lot of Crisis Core fans out there.
Yeah, no kidding.
However, the second of its legacies is less celebratory. As of this recording, Nintendo is currently facing 3 class action lawsuits for unlawful, deceptive, and/or fraudulent business practices or unlawful conduct for the dreaded Joy-Con drift. You've seen it, you know exactly what it is, and if you're a Nintendo Switch owner, you've likely experienced it yourself. Last year, 72% of IGN's readers claimed to have experienced at least one set of Joy-Con drifting, which is an extremely high number considering that Nintendo's consoles are historically long-lasting. For the better part of the last few years, most have chalked drift up to defective hardware or Nintendo's negligence to do literally anything about the issue. When the PS5 was released in November of 2020, Sony's DualSense controller was lauded for innovation, but it wasn't long before more and more reports of controller drift on this new hardware began popping up as well.
It would appear Sony is taking a page out of Nintendo's book because PS5 DualSense controllers appear to also be suffering from controller drift.
Now Sony is facing its own class action lawsuit over controller drift. This got us to thinking, why is this happening with more and more controllers? Drift never used to be a thing that gamers had to worry about, but it seems like no current gen controllers can escape controller drift, and we want to know why. To figure out the science behind controller drift, we went to the University of San Francisco to talk to Aaron White.
My name's Aaron White. I am an astrophysicist. I work as an instructor at San Francisco State in USF here in San Francisco.
We figured we'd better start with the basics and have Aaron walk us through exactly how a controller works.
All right, so fundamentally, the way any electronics work, whether it be a game controller or a remote control, a phone, is right in the name. It's the electrons. Moving electrons from place to place is how we generate electric current, and that current is what supplies the energy that allows those devices to run and do all the processes that they want to.
Okay, let's get dangerous. This is the Sony DualShock 4, or at least it was before we completely voided the warranty on it, which we don't recommend doing. When you get underneath the shell, it's easy to recognize a few key parts. First, the battery. This is where our electrons are generated and our current begins. Next, the circuit board, where you can see all these different paths that the electrons can take, forming a sort of electrical skeleton.
The circuit board is designed to send current to different places to accomplish different goals. To make a signal for when a button is pressed, for example, maybe you want to power a light or track the position of your thumbstick, which is key for when we're talking about drift. Those boards are designed very carefully to send current from only one place to another place with a very specific control. We have lots of different things that we want to accomplish on a device like a controller. So there's many, many different paths through which we send that current to accomplish all those different tasks. Now, not only do we need to control how that current moves around, we also need to control how fast it goes. So if you just have a wire that has no resistance, no way to slow the current down, it will build up a tremendous amount of heat almost instantaneously. So inside of all these circuit boards are what we call resistive elements, things that work against the flow of that current to slow it down. Depending on the job you want to do, you may want a different amount of current, which is going to correspond to a different amount of energy. So you need a different value of resistance. So essentially, the more resistive material energy has to flow through, the lower the current you're going to get.
Right, which means if you're pressing a button, you're closing a gap and completing a circuit. This generates a signal that your console then translates into your on-screen character doing something awesome. See? Awesome. Now buttons we understand, but what about thumbsticks?
For a thumbstick though, we need to know not just if it's been pressed, but by how much and in which direction it's been pressed. We need a signal that is analogous to the input, and that's where we get the term analog stick from. When you press your control stick, you're actually turning 2 small wheels underneath it and an electrical component called a potentiometer. Those wheels are in contact with the tract of resistive material, and they act similarly to how buttons work to fill in the gap in a circuit. The difference here, it's not just an on or off signal. So the amount of resistive material the current has to flow through is determined by the orientation of the wheel. There's a small metal piece on it called a wiper, and that moves along with the wheel, choosing where on the track the connection to the circuit is made. So if you jam the stick to the side, it turns the wheel all the way, and does that such that the entire resistor track is used to complete the path for the circuit. So you have a very large amount of resistance in that case, and a relatively low current. If you nudge it just a little bit, the wiper moves to only use a small part of the track surface, allowing the current to flow over it relatively easily, creating a large current. Every different orientation of the thumbstick results in a different amount of current and a unique signal. Your controller registers the current values from each wheel and reports those as the X and Y positions of the stick. It then turns that information over to the game console to move you forward, spin your camera, or do whatever the game designers want that stick to do and what they want that motion to represent. So when your controller is working properly, there's a one-to-one relationship between the current that's reported and the position of the stick. When we're experiencing stick drift, something is causing that current value to change when we're not actually changing the stick position, or it's giving us an incorrect position for where the stick actually is. That could happen for countless reasons. There could be something like dust or skin flakes along the resistant track or on the wiper that would change the flow of current between the contacts in a pretty unpredictable way. The conductive material along the track could be damaged from wear and tear, which would change the resistance across certain parts of it, which would trigger a bad signal. There could also have been an error in the manufacturing process, which would cause issues with the track right out of the box. Unless you take your controller apart and start physically testing the signal across the potentiometer, it's nearly impossible to tell what's causing the problem.
Great, now that I understand a little bit more about what's happening inside the controller, I asked Aaron to apply his big science brain and help us hypothesize just why we're seeing increasing rates of drift, specifically with newer controllers.
So if you crack open a DualShock, an Xbox, or a Switch Pro controller, you're gonna find the same basic potentiometer design in all. There's some folks over at iFixit that have done some really good investigative work and tracked down the actual make and model of the potentiometers found inside of a PS5 controller. And they discovered that the rating for those, how long they're expected until they start to go bad, is for 100,000 or 2 million cycles, depending on which exact model is used. Rough math from those folks suggests that that could work out to be just a few hundred hours before those potentiometers start to wear out, at which point you might start seeing stick drift.
The term cycles here is pretty nebulous, so I did some digging and found that cycles can be described as a lot of different movements, but to boil it down, it essentially means this. Or this, or this, or this. But what's even more troubling is that Aaron just said that these potentiometers may wear out within a few hundred hours. Now granted, this is based on the manufacturer's minimum for optimal function, but that seems like a minuscule amount given the length of modern games. So I hopped over to How Long to Beat, a handy little website that averages user data and lets folks know how long they'll spend with a game before they move on to the next, just to add a little context. Assuming that here a few means three, and that we're only sticking to the main storyline, that means that our controllers would start to drift after 28.6 playthroughs of Gears 5, 12.5 playthroughs of The Last of Us Part 2, 8.82 playthroughs of Final Fantasy VII Remake, 6 playthroughs of The Legend of Zelda Breath of the Wild, 3 playthroughs of Persona 5 Royale, and roughly 12% of World of Warcraft, if you're playing that on a controller for some reason. Anyway, all of this to say that it's becoming increasingly apparent that potentiometers in modern controllers have a limited lifetime that's not being advertised to consumers. But where does that issue really lie?
There's a common adage that shows up in engineering circles that your design needs to be three things. It needs to be good, it needs to be cheap, and it needs to be reliable. You only get to pick two of those things. So it seems like controller manufacturers have focused on the first two at the expense of the third. So we expect modern controllers to have high precision. You want to be able to gently nudge the stick when you're sneaking and then jam it forward when you're running. And you want that to be accurately represented in game. That fine-tuned feedback requires a lot of sensitivity, a very high level of sensitivity. And that makes it vulnerable to the problems that we talked about earlier. Controllers also need to be affordable. If you look online for potentiometers, you can find replacements that only cost a couple of dollars. So it's totally possible that there are higher quality potentiometers available that could stand more wear and tear. But those are going to be more expensive and they're going to drive up the cost of the controllers. When you're already charging $60, $70, $80 for a controller, that's a really big ask to make of your customers. All right, so what we're left with is this middle ground where we have high sensitivity, relatively lower cost, but always having that looming possibility your controller can start to malfunction without any warning. I think if we had more clear communication from hardware manufacturers about how long these controllers are expected to last, you could at least avoid some degree of the backlash that we're seeing.
Now I know what you're thinking, what about the warranty, right? Right, most controllers will come with a standard 1-year warranty right out of the box, but consider my example from earlier. A casual gamer will put considerably fewer hours onto that controller in a single year than a hardcore gamer will. An RPG fan uses a controller completely differently than someone who only plays fighting games. The difference in usage during that year will vary wildly, and some gamers will sprint to that 300 hour mark, you know who you are, while others won't even come close to that number in a year or more. So, long story short, something's gotta change with the way the Nintendos and Sonys and Microsofts of the world handled this situation. And going back to Aaron's engineering rule of three, we asked him to offer some solutions for each design necessity.
They can redesign how we track motion from analog sticks to start with. We can focus on using higher quality potentiometers that don't wear down as easily. We could try to design them in such a way to be more isolated from dust and other contaminants. Of course, controllers have all seemed to converge to the same basic design somewhere around 20 years ago. So that sort of drastic change to how these things look like internally would require a lot of engineering work and probably come at an even greater cost. Another option would be to make controllers that are more modular, so you can swap out potentiometers once they start going bad. As a general rule, though, manufacturers really don't want you opening up your controllers and potentially damaging the internal parts. I could, however, imagine something like the jumper pack that you found in the N64 that was designed so users could swap out the internal parts, but actually needed to open up the system and expose its guts to the elements. The last option, and of course the one that's going to be least popular, is just to be more explicit about the expected lifetimes of controllers. If we knew that controllers were really designed to last 1,000 hours or whatever that number might be, we could at least plan and not feel like we're just rolling the dice on how long before they start to give out and malfunction.
At the very least, these suggestions would help establish some standards to keep manufacturers accountable and potentially circumvent some of these big-time lawsuits. Having clearer communication about the life expectancy of controllers would allow for more open conversation about what exactly we're paying for when we're forking over $70 for a new or replacement DualSense. Of course, there are definitely caveats to be considered when we're talking about corporate messaging or the lifetime expectancy in electronics, but I thought Aaron really nailed it when he said,
"There's not a clear answer, but the more consumers push back, the sooner that manufacturers are going to have to stop kicking the can down the road and find a solution to these problems."
Thanks to Aaron for explaining controller drift to us, and thank you for watching. You can read Aaron's full piece over on IGN.com, but while you're here, why don't you check out my friends Brian and Tom talking about Joy-Con drift from last year, or take a look at our DualSense review. Until next time, stay safe, stay smart, and keep it locked to IGN.